Oregon football with Mike Belotti.
Behind Josh Klein, second and goal from the six. Turn to give it to Maurice up the middle, left and there. Cuts it outside. Look out. 5-3-2. Touchdown, Maurice Morris. Maurice Morris was supposed to go inside. He went outside and walked into the end zone. He got outside the containment for you.
Hello, everyone. Most of you with hoarse voices today recovering from an amazing Saturday at Autzen Stadium. Welcome to Oregon Football with Mike Belotti, Joe Johnsonte, along with Mark Larson and head coach Mike Belotti.
Over the next hour, we'll relive that dominating win over the sixth-ranked team in the nation. Hear from the players, get you set for next week. Another big one with the Washington Huskies. We'll also catch up with the game day crew that helped make Saturday so special. But first, Coach Belotti, congratulations. Great win, big win, national TV, and you guys stepped up.
Thanks, Mark. Yeah, it was a great victory, I think, certainly where the stage was set for all of that. But we had a lot of help from the fans. I think the whole city of Eugene, the state of Oregon, as I said, and our kids played very well, very proud. They had a great plan on offense and defense. They executed that plan. We made a difference on special teams. And, you know, I think UCLA had some chances. We were fortunate a couple of them did not work for them. But we made our own breaks, and I feel real good about where we're at right now.
Let's talk a little bit more about the emotion in the stadium and the fans, 45,000. And they really came to play as well, and they really helped your team.
Oh, they were awesome. The noise level, I don't know if I've ever heard as loud. Some people say it's the loudest it's ever been. I don't know because it seems like that all the time to me. But the intensity throughout the entire game made a huge difference. I know it disrupted UCLA's offensive timing. They had three straight procedural penalties one time. And it's very difficult. And the combination of the turf, the fans, the odds and magic, the wind, the sun, whatever it may be, is continuing to work.
How important is this win? I mean, like we said, national TV audience, everybody was watching, and this time you guys really finally stepped up and did the job.
Well, there's at least two reasons. One is because it's the first Pac-10 league game, and it gives us the first step on the way, again, to winning the conference championship. And we go one game at a time, don't get me wrong. The other thing, when you can beat a ranked team, I think it's your place. It obviously catches people's attention.
Well, it was an exciting day. It started early for the fans, about 3,000 out for that game day. We'll show you that a little bit later. But we're going to start out with the first quarter. Perfect day, 73 degrees. The fans ready. Adam Kinderbrew ready with the flag. And here we go. Ducks take the field and a big third down right away. And you go to Maurice Morris.
Morris done a great job. He was ready to go. I think fired up about his first Pac-10 game. He did a great job running and seeing the holes, creating some of those great runs.
And there were plenty of holes early for Maurice, again, carrying the load, and again, another 13-yard gain here, some great blocking and good speed.
Great job on the draw, very patient on the draw play, a right side wipe down the their side of the line, and he bounced out for a nice thing. You'll see it here.
Chance to take another look at it. You know, Maurice being more patient as a runner, isn't he?
Absolutely. And, well, he's learning, too. You know, it takes a while to get comfortable with the blocking scheme and realize, because defenses don't just stand there, they're not static. They're moving all the time, so the hole may change.
And it seemed like so many times he was just one person away from breaking it open. This time, though, tough running inside, and you do everything.
Absolutely. He's a warrior. He came to play, and I said that. It was his baptism under fire, and I think he really passed the test.
Unfortunately, the drive stalls. You end up punting at a field goal formation.
Nice job, and I'm not sure our spot was correct there. It was down around the 10, I think, they moved it out, but nice job.
So here come the Bruins. They can't get a playoff. It is so loud in the stadium. There's finally do get a playoff. They are stuffed. Foster brought down and find the things to come on the day.
A lot of ducks in on that tackle. I think Saul Patu got to him first behind the line, and then it's about five or six, and that's what our plan was all day long.
So after a punt, Ducks have great field position. It's Morris again, 11 yards this time, and again, one player away, and then you go to Maurice Morris through the air.
And Joy back to throw. Pressure comes from the screen. Morris has it and a blocker. He'll get the first down. Moore across the 20 inside of the 16-yard line. Just inside the 16.
It's a little quick screen. You can see it set up here. Mo gets out to the right side, following Joy first. Forster and a couple other blockers down the field. Actually, sort of, Joy can't quite keep up with him. Well, that's good. And Mo just turns it on. Big first down.
And then the Ducks throw in a surprise for the Bruin defense.
UCLA, Willis in motion to the left. He'll come back and get the handoff going back to the right with the block. Turn the corner. 10, 5, 3. Did he get it in? I don't think so. 1 yard line. He reached. He tried to reach it in.
Very well-designed play, and Jason Willis has a knack with this great sense of timing. This play looked good all week long. He does a great job of turning the corner. He's a running back wide receiver in high school from the L.A. area, and I think he wanted to do well today. He had great motivation.
And a great day for Jason Willis. First and goal from the one. You send the big guy Josh Line into the line, and for a close play here, Coach.
Yeah, almost disaster, though, too. We've got to secure that football. That was a mistake. We're fortunate to get the ball back. And again, we've got to go in and keep our pads and our feet on the ground in that play.
Turns out to be a seven-point play.
Joey on the keep, going to turn it up, and did he get it in? Yes, he did! Touchdown, Joey Harrington!
Well, this is the option, and Joey elected to keep it. He saw the goal line there and just powered in. I think he was a little bit excited and frustrated that after the whistle, he got a little bit thrown to the ground, but we got the ball in the end zone. That's the most important thing.
So, 7-0, Oregon taking the lead. The defense continues to play great. Garrett Sable, once again, to go to the air.
McCann, back to throw the ball. Sets up, looks, throws it down the middle. It is intercepted! Bowman has the ball! Rashad! Straight arms one and gets at the 40, inside of the 35, into the 30. He's on his feet at the 20 and down. First down, Oregon at the UCLA 20. Rashad.
About bracketing the receiver. The ball has to be thrown over Steve Smith. It's just tipped. Rashad is right there, Johnny, on the spot. Then he becomes like the human wall. It's unbelievable here. Steve Smith. The second move, and we could let him, as I've said many times, he could return punts and kicks. He's just too valuable to us on defense.
We're going for his favorite target, Keenan Auer, and just missed him. Good play here by the defense. And so the Ducks have to attempt a field goal, and Josh Franco coming on, and Josh had a tough day.
Into the wind, and you see it, he just missed it on the left side. The wind was blowing across.
Time to turn it up a notch, and they run a play. There's one false start, Coach, in the first of a three-play stretch where they just...
I just tell you, the noise level down in the stadium is so loud, you can... When you hear stuff from the fans, it sounds like a...
Count all... heard. So you're faced with a 3rd and 25 all of a sudden. The crowd is going crazy. What's the use? Kick. And it works out pretty well.
Almost got this.
It comes to a close with the Ducks leading it. Very pleased as you come out of that quarter with the lead, and I know you want it to be more, though, than the 7-0.
I did, but I was very pleased with our defense. I think we made a statement about the fact we were not going to let them run the football. The crowd got into it early, just exactly as we talked that we needed to keep their offense off balance, and we were moving the ball, again, which is good, but we...
About the whisper play, they're going to, whisper down the line so everybody knows the snap count. What did you see?
I don't think they were able to whisper. I'm not sure. Very difficult on those linemen because they're trying to keep their eyes up. See the line. And it's hard to focus.
Welcome back, everyone. Oregon leading at 7-0. And, Coach, the one thing you want to guard against in this situation is that so much emotion at the beginning of the game, you don't want any letdowns at all. And the crowd didn't let you do that.
No, I think the crowd stayed in, but more importantly, we controlled our emotion, didn't do anything stupid, didn't make mistakes, played within ourselves, and I think obviously watched UCLA somewhat make some mistakes that hurt them. I think our kids just got stronger because of that.
So second quarter, Ducks getting plenty of chances to put points on the board. UCLA completely shut down on offense as we go to the highlights, and Mark, we pick it up with the Ducks on the move and Corso on the phone.
Corso becoming a Duck fan, put on the Duck head Saturday morning. Telling everybody how great the stadium is. Start out with Maurice Morris, just like we started the first quarter. Nice gain of 9 yards. Ducks then go to the air and find the big tight end.
Morris in the backfield at the 34. Quick throw. It's caught tight end. Peel. Boom. Across the 40. Down his feet. Breaks free at the 50. Down across the yard line. That's the kind of tight end.
Joey Harrington to Justin Peele and the Ramblin' Wreck takes over right there. Great job. Perfect in terms of the timing of it. And then he uses his balance and strength to break two couple tackles there. Protects the ball going down. Big game.
So you're on the move, and then Joey is forced to go back and scramble on this play. Pretty well to get out and make what he can out of it.
It's too bad. That was just one man to beat the bracket or outside receivers, and Joey's forced to run. We had to settle for the field goal.
Franco from 39 yards out. This time on the other side, just barely missed that one. So two missed field goals, Coach, and UCLA with the ball now. But again, your defense steps up.
Nice job. Steve Smith right in the hole. Great fill by the safety. He had to move from corner to safety when Ryan Mitchell got hurt. And that was a big switch because he hadn't practiced this week, so he did a very nice job.
All right, UCLA then flushed, and Ryan McCann touched his knee, and that's called a sack. Loss of six. Bruins punt it away. Ducks take over. Third and 10. Harrington scrambling again, and I mean, he just about got there.
Yeah, he tiptoed the sidelines extremely well, just came up short, and it's too bad. He did a great job because he's flushed out of the pocket on the backside.
Curtis Doerr back to punt. He's got the wind at his back here, and you get a great play out of Sonny Cook down by the goal line.
We work on this all the time, trying to get back there and catch the football, and Sonny executed it perfectly. Great kick by Curtis Doerr.
But the Bruins get out of trouble here. McCann finally connects here with Freddie Mitchell on the other end. Mitchell had eight catches on Saturday. This one out to the 41. And, I mean, Bowman was there, but Mitchell had...
And unfortunately, we got the ball out, but to the luck of the... out of bounds where he could recover it.
And then Foster, this is his biggest run of the day. Almost took it. Slipped down right there. Gain of 18. But then the defense tightens up again big time. And Deshaun Foster going to be strung out again here.
Great job on this, just pursuit. Man.
It forces the Bruins into a big-time mistake.
On the option, going to go left, pitches it on to the turf, and the ball's loose. He's got the football. Deshaun Foster couldn't get back to the pitch. It hit the turf. His feet.
You can see this is created by immediate pressure by our defensive end. Saw two coming off the edge. Hits him just as he pitches the ball. Deshaun cannot handle it. Kevin Mitchell screaming in from the outs from his inside linebacker spot, and we cover it up. Big time play because they had started to generate some momentum, and that turned it around.
So the Ducks trying to take advantage now off the turnover with a good drive here. Harrington hits Marshawn Tucker, and Tuck just about got it, but out of bounds there. And then another quick drop. Can you talk about it, Coach? A quick drop here, and Tucker slipped one guy and almost slipped in.
Yeah, we said a lot about wanting to have a rhythm and tempo to throw in the football and not put pressure on the offensive line. He does a great job making the first guy miss and almost takes this to the house. The safety's got one shot at him, just barely get him out of bounds, and Marshawn knew it. He knew he had a shot there.
Joey back under center then as he's going to look to throw again. Oregon making inroads now into UCLA territory, but the rush comes. Joey puts it down, and he puts his head down for a gain of seven. So a big, big fourth down and two coming, and the Ducks are going for it.
One back behind him. On the option, pitch to Willis. He's got the first down and more. 25, 23-yard line and down. Coach, we listen to you.
Great job by our offensive staff coming up. Jeff Tedford coming up with this scheme, leaving a receiver in the backfield, shifting a fullback out, creating a matchup that we wanted, and we run the option. Jason Willis, again, handling the football, which he doesn't do a lot, but he's made some significant plays, and I think, as I said, he might command the ball more in the future.
Now Joey to the air, Keenan Howery. Nice play here, gets inside the 10-yard line, sets up a first and goal at the 7. Ducks trying to get it into the end zone and go to Maurice Morris, but Maurice stacked up here. Good job by the Bruins.
We probably bounced that one out too soon. The play would have gone up inside. Might not have been a big play. Would have been a positive game.
On comes Frankel for attempt number three.
Lord, but it's down. The kick is on the way up, and it looks good. Fans say yes, and so do the officials. He got it. 1:24 left in the first half. Oregon gets a 3-10-0 on top of the Bruins here at Autzen Stadium. Back after this from State Farm.
One of the things is he missed the first one into the wind, pushed it across. He, the second time he missed, he actually thought it was going to blow the wind. I said, hit right down the middle, which he did. I think he got his confidence and rhythm back.
And that's the way it goes into halftime, 10-0. And tell us a little bit of what you're saying to your kids at halftime.
Well, yeah, I think we say the same things. Half of football is gone, but half remains. The most important half remains. We have to continue to put the pressure on, do the things we've been doing. I was very pleased with the lack of penalties, lack of mistakes, played within ourselves. We had to continue the intensity on defense, stop the run, not give up the big plays, and take advantage of opportunities on offense.
Does it feel at all like the Wisconsin game? I mean, you guys really dominated the Bruins and still only up 10-0.
To a degree. You know, I think that UCLA is very, very explosive. That was my biggest concern. And I thought we could play better. I knew, though, at home that little thing is with you, you know, sitting on your shoulder. And we just needed to continue to play hard.
Welcome back, everyone. Well, there's a tremendous amount of excitement heading into this week's game against the Bruins, thanks in part to ESPN's Game Day Show, which broadcasted live outside of Autzen Stadium prior to the game. Our Steve Huszczyk was there bright and early, and he found the bright lights shining on the Oregon football program and its fans.
It's game day, and boy, is there hype. ESPN dropped their hats in the ring for their first trip back to the West Coast since 1998.
I don't watch ESPN a whole lot, but I watch Oregon.
And this week, the Ducks hold the national spotlight.
Obviously, the conference has not been nearly as strong as it is this year. I mean, so many times when it comes to choosing the site of the show, the Pac-10 might be just a narrow second choice or a third choice, but it hasn't quite been the biggest game in the country.
Darren Fabre held off sleep to be a front man to the festivities.
I got here about 3:30 in the a.m. actually. I was the first person here, and I'll be the last person to leave.
I just couldn't get over the fans this early. It's the largest crowd we've ever had by far early in the morning. And that really speaks well to Oregon football.
A lot of people hate Corso, but I got a pretty good feeling that guy's going to be putting on some duck. He's got a streak going. 14 straight weeks, Lee Corso, the coach, hasn't missed. Mains, will he don the UCLA blue, or will the Ducks shock the nation?
Oregon's got a 16-game winning streak. I got a 14-game winning streak putting those heads on it. I just hope they don't screw it up for us.
I thought he might go with the home crowd. I think he's always mindful of things that look kind of suspicious. And when a team that has been beating Alabama and Michigan as an underdog to a team that's beaten Nevada and Idaho, he's like, wait a minute, now there must be something to this whole Autzen Stadium thing.
Lee Corso, the hero. But fame can be a fleeting phenomenon. No matter how much hype, you've got to come up with the goods. For the Oregon Sports Network, I'm Steve Huszczyk.
All right, thanks, Steve. What a fun day for everybody involved and a good showcase for the Oregon football community. Well, now it's time for this week's Internet poll. First, last week's question and the results. Which of Oregon's bowl wins do you think is the most significant in the history of the program? There have been a few, and we gave you some choices. You said the 1989 Independence Bowl, second place, last year's Sun Bowl win. Then it's the 17 Rose Bowl and the 63 Sun Bowl, followed by the 97 Vegas Bowl. Now for this week, here come the Huskies. Rivalry time. We want to know, with those dreaded dogs come to town, which is the bigger rivalry? Think it's Oregon versus Washington, or is it the Civil War, Oregon and Oregon State? Go to KZI.com to place your vote. We'll have the results from this week's Internet poll next week on Oregon Football with Mike Belotti. Now, speaking of the Huskies coming to town this week, there have been many great plays in this rivalry over the last few years. Of course, none bigger than the play that has become the trademark for the Oregon football program and for the voice of the Ducks. Here's the call of the game with Jerry Allen.
Of the game with Jerry Allen.
You hope you'll go through a career and get to be a part of a great game, a season, and maybe a play, but you're never prepared for it. When Kenny Wheaton picked that pass off and Damon Heward went the other way, all the work through the years and the preparation for that moment, right out the window.
Heward, you're going to go back to throw the ball. Sets up, looks, throws toward the corner of the end zone. It is intercepted! Intercepted! The Ducks have the ball! Down to the 35, the 40. Kenny Wheaton's going to score! Kenny Wheaton's going to score! 20, the 10, touchdown! Kenny Wheaton, and the interception! The most improbable finish to the football game!
It was from as low as you could get to as high as you could get in the blink of an eye, there's no better feeling.
Oregon football with Mike Belotti, Joe Johnsonti along with Mark Larson and head coach Mike Belotti.
And it's 10-0 heading into the third quarter. You feel good about that?
I did. I felt like we had dominated the game to a degree. We need to take advantage of our offensive opportunities, but our defense needed to keep up the pressure.
All right, let's go to the third quarter highlights. UCLA determined to make a game of it, trying to take advantage of the fact that not all the fans were back in their seats yet from all the halftime entertainment, and they did that with some quick counts, and they start moving the ball a little bit. Foster, though, stacked up on this play by Saul Patu.
Great job coming off that weak side. Saul has such great quickness, he can run down a back from the far side.
Then it's McCann going to the air, looking for his big receiver, Brian Poley-Dixon, and a great play here by Brian Johnson.
Brian Johnson, that's a warrior play. I tell you what, that's one-on-one with the guy that's 6'6 or whatever he is, and he went up and knocked the ball out.
UCLA punted. Oregon, though, punted after a three and out, so UCLA back with the ball, and on third and nine, McCann for 8 yards to Poley-Dixon, but a roughing the passer penalty gives him a first down.
That's 15 yards tacked on, unfortunately. It was close, but we'd all like him to protect the quarterback.
Defense tightening up, though. Garrett Sable meets Deshaun Foster again in the backfield and stringing it out. So out comes the field goal unit, win at the back, and a long kick and a nice kick by their kicker there.
Did a nice job, put it right through. And again, with the wind, that's still a good kick, though, because it was swirling. Mm-hmm.
Their defense forces another duck punt, and all of a sudden they seem more confident. McCann to Poley-Dixon for a gain of 8, and Coach, you mentioned that maybe your team was caught a little asleep at the start of the quarter.
Well, we've got to do something about the second half, and I don't know what it is. I think we need to come out and scrimmage a little bit, to tell you the truth, to get ready, but we've got to have better intensity on defense.
And the touchdown by Freddie Mitchell ties the game, and you've dominated so far, and all of a sudden it's 10-10. It's a brand new ball game.
Yeah, and that was a great play. They did a very nice job, good throw and catch, and we just got caught asleep.
Oregon responds with a great drive, starting at the 37. Howery for 14, and that's where Joey goes up top again.
Willis wide right with Howery. Tucker comes left on first down. And Maurice Morris, the eye back. Here's a quick throw out. Howery with a catch, going to try to get it outside, and does. First down, down the sideline, and out of bounds, up at the 34-yard line. Howery did that on his own.
Nice job by Joey to Keenan. This is a little read play, and Keenan does a great job here of taking the ball, freezing the defensive back, who obviously misunderstood his speed and just went around the outside. Crucial yardage.
UCLA does make some big plays on defense at this point in the game. Howery, on this play, coming up right here, will be open. Looks like it's going to be a huge play for the Ducks as Harrington throws the ball up, but it gets knocked away at the last moment.
Yeah, it's a great job. DB drives his hands up through the ball, and that's exactly what they're taught, and that's perfect technique.
Faced with fourth down, and the Ducks are going for it again.
Stops, looks, throws it downfield, open, caught. First down at the 17-yard line. I thought he lost the handle on it, but LaCorey Collins held it like a loaf of bread after he made the catch.
Boy, that's a gutty call.
Well, that truly is no man's land for a coach. You have a decision there of whether you're going to go for it, punt it, try a long field goal. We decided to go for it. Great throw and catch. LaCorey Collins, we call him Big Play, and he just lives up to his name.
So the Ducks have a first down. They keep the ball and go back to Maurice Morris, who had so much success in the first half. This time, Morris, nice 6-yard gain off the option play. Well, the Ducks would have to settle for another field goal try into an incredible win.
Josh lines it up, left hash mark. As we wait for the snap, good, placement good. The kick is up, very high, and good. He just got it through.
Whoa. That kick was a tough one, only because of the wind itself. But we told Josh, when you're that close, put it right down the middle. He didn't get good contact on that thing. I think he was trying to steer it just a little bit. But he said to me, Coach, it was good.
Yeah, it's 3 points. 55 yards and 11 plays. It settled the game down. The Ducks had the lead there, and they seemed to be inspired on defense. Foster stopped right there by Mitchell for no gain. And then McCann right here under pressure, going to throw incomplete.
Great pressure by Saul Patu coming off the edge. He's got to contain that sprint out off the play action. Did a great job there.
The Ducks are bringing it again.
And they are. Back to throw. McCann hit, then tackle back at the 20-yard line. Steve Smith got to him.
And he wasn't the only one, because I think Garrett...
Actually, Kevin Mitchell and Steve Smith combined. You see Kevin Mitchell comes right up the middle, makes two guys miss. Steve comes off the edge, goes high. Kevin goes low. It's great pressure, and it's good to get to the quarterback because you want to make him think about that every time he drops back to pass.
So the Bruins forced to punt it away to the dangerous Keenan Howard.
Steps up, booms, a very nice rolling spiral, catchable and returnable, though, from the 29. Bobble now picked up. 35, 40, gets to the way. 50, oh, he tripped over his own man and went down. However, he goes down at the UCLA 45. He ran over the top of Keith Lewis.
Very, and does a great job and great blocking down the field. You can see as he splits the two ducks coming down, call them ducks, the lead players, and then just heads off. It's off. I think it's Keith. And Keenan didn't expect to be tackled by his own man there, but he was one-on-one with the kicker. He'd have made it.
The Ducks have great field position. Joey Harrington on the option. Kind of overlooked. 31 yards rushing on the day for Joey. Had a nice job running the ball.
Did a very positive job. Took off there. That's an option run for him, obviously, and he saw that he could get past it. Ducked under, broke a tackle, and carried it for big yardage.
And then it's Jason Willis again. 35 yards rushing for Jason. It's been fooled the cameraman, fooled the Bruins, too.
Same play we'd run earlier. Again, almost results in a touchdown, almost results in a first down again.
Down to the UCLA 17, and then Maurice Morris taking the pitch on this play. Thought he might get in. He squirts the middle there, gets tackled down to the 11, and the quarter comes to a close. The Ducks coach knocking on the door again. You got to feel good that you've regained the momentum in this football game.
No question. I think that was truly important. I said on the sideline, we needed to survive that third quarter because we gave them the win, gave them the football. Actually, they took the ball. We gave them the win. And I knew it was going to be difficult, but our defense came up big. Offensively, we were starting to get more control of the game right there, and I felt real good going into the fourth quarter.
Welcome back, everyone. Here we go to the fourth quarter, and the Ducks, with the momentum, as we talked about, now you've got the wind at your back and you're driving.
We're down deep in their territory. I just felt good that we'd gained control of the game back a little bit. Felt good where we're at. I knew we were going to get a minimum of 3 points. Would have rather had a touchdown here, but let's see what happens.
The other part of it, the Oregon offense wearing the Bruin defense down. They've been out there all day, and the crowd is wearing them down as well. So let's go to the highlights. The Ducks start the quarter deep in UCLA territory. With the win, Morris taking on the loss of 2 yards. Just had a chance here, but he just runs out of room. They say his knee hits, Coach, but it didn't.
His knee did not touch. That's one of the greatest runs in the history of the world right there. It's unfortunate. I saw that shoe on the ground. I think they may have thought it touched, but he did not.
So here comes Josh Frankel once again.
Snap from center. Placement. The kick is on the way up. Plenty high in distance. And it's down the middle. Three more. 16-10 Oregon. With the lead here with 13.
So the Ducks lead 16-10. Defense again. Foster stacked up by Matt Smith.
Great job by Matt Smith. Came back. He did several of these plays where just came through the line of scrimmage and made big plays.
Brian McCann, rough day continues. Incomplete here. Over the middle and tipped there by Steve Smith. A big three and out for the Bruins, and momentum remains with the Ducks. Harrington going up top to Sammy Parker again, and you like to get this guy involved.
Yeah, it's a quick screen to the outside, just a short throw, but he makes a 7-8 yard gain out of it, and he's going to break one of those soon.
Time to get Morris involved again.
Morris cuts it up. He'll get a first down of more. 40. Get a block outside, inside 30. Down to the 26. Maybe the 20. They'll cut the 27-yard line.
Boy, somebody's underwear is left on the field out there.
I think that was Maurice's best run of the day, to tell you the truth. He showed speed. He cut. He made people miss. Showed acceleration. I was really excited. This is that same misdirection toss. Again, you see he starts out, makes the guy miss there, cuts back under the safety, outruns 47, and then it's, you know, just one guy again, and he knows it. He felt that. You could tell us the frustration when he got up.
All right, then Joey Harrington going to go up top this time. And Jason Willis, well, we know he can run the ball, but guess what? He can catch, too. And, Coach, Jason Willis, a big part of the offense.
He had a big game. I think he was very motivated to perform, and he did the most of it when he got a chance to touch that football.
Willis, a former walk-on coach, recruited by UCLA to play defense, and he came to Oregon. He proved it to him in this game.
He did, and we utilized him not just as a receiver. He carried the ball, caught the ball. He's one of our best blockers down the field, too. So he's doing a great job. We're really pleased with his progress.
So back to the ground game. The Bruins can't handle Maurice Morris.
Harrington handed off to Morris. Big hole inside the 10 of the 5 of the 4. Close to a first down. Ball pops loose, but it was down at the 4.
Huge hole over that left side. Really great blocking. If you watch this again, I can't tell who our guard is, but do a great job. Fullback comes through. Mo carrying guys for another 2 yards there. Ball was down on the ground.
All right, now it's time to bang it in. Josh Line, the big fullback, will move it a couple yards down to the 2 yard line. He also then moved it down to the 1 yard line, and that set up once again Maurice Morris.
Maurice behind Josh Line on second and goal from the one. Turn to give it to Maurice. Diving in for the score. Maurice Morris, touchdown, Oregon.
And that's just offensive line push, Jerry. The whole time.
Great surge on that right side. You see Joey Forster, Lee Gundy, Jeff Austin in there, and they just push that thing right back in the end zone. Mo goes up over the top, following Josh Line, his fullback. You see it again from this angle. Great job, just great power, gets the surge. Line surge allows him to get that takeoff, and he lands in the end zone.
So 22-10, and the Bruins start to fall apart on what was a long day for the sixth-ranked team in the nation.
Receivers left, one right. Ball fumble, and it's loose. It's in the secondary. It's down to the 44-yard line. It's fallen on by Matt Smith. Oregon has the football. The snap never got back to the pan.
Well, obviously there was a miscommunication as to whether the quarterback was there. The snap hits the center in the behind, and then it gets kicked out. Matt Smith, great job of following the ball because nobody else knew where it was. Then, unfortunately, a late shot by UCLA, and then somebody on our side retaliated, either said something, but offsetting penalties there. So we get the ball. Huge turnover.
And Matt said later he would have liked to take it in, but wanted to make sure he got the ball. Oregon had it on the 4, first down, loss of 2 there. One time Maurice Morris would be stopped, but it didn't matter. The Ducks push across the clincher.
Cuts it outside. Look out. 5-3-2. Touchdown, Maurice Morris. Maurice Morris was supposed to go inside.
Great job. Inside, we're blocking very, very well. They really pack the paint. So Moe freezes them, steps outside, turns it on, makes a safety miss. And then again, the whole thing here is surviving Joey Harrington, who's trailing the play, coming in, gets tripped, and almost hurts Mo worse. So again, great job by Mo getting the end zone.
After that, just for good measure, the defense puts a stamp on it.
Pressure comes, can't get away from it. Tackled back at the 17-yard line.
Seth McEwen, Jerry.
The sack by McEwen.
Seth McEwen on the sack does a nice job, a little TE stunt on that outside. He comes inside, and he's strong. You watch him. He just grabs and wrestles the quarterback down or grabs him by the hip and just pulls. That's awesome. He's got great strength, and excited for him to get that sack.
And then the Ducks make it back-to-back.
Well, run back and again, bad snap, but he gets it, and McCann slips, goes down again, back at the 5-yard line. Saul Patu this time. Boy, the Oregon defense.
Saw Patu, same thing from the other side now, doing some line games in there. Gets a great start. He's got tremendous quickness. And nice thing again, grabs him, bulldogs him down.
So the Bruins wave the white flag, and this one is over 29-10. Coach, after the game, a lot of emotion on the field, and you mentioned that maybe this one is one of the biggest wins in your tenure at the University of Oregon.
Well, I'd like to hope they're bigger in the future to come, but certainly at this point, to beat a ranked team, start the Pac-10 League with that, have game day here and the national broadcast, that's awesome. It's a great stage that was set, and our kids responded very well.
To beat it by 19 points, is that also a statement that, I mean, this wasn't a close game?
No, and I'm pleased about that. I think certainly we got a chance to relax a little bit at the end. They had some opportunities, we had some opportunities. I think the score was indicative of the type of game it was and the type of performance that our coaches and our team put together.
Well, there was a mad crush on the field after the game, as usual, and amidst the rush of the fans, we found some very, very happy Ducks, all of them tasting victory over UCLA for the first time.
UCLA came in here and they talked the talk, but they couldn't walk the walk. Yeah! We just stepped up real well, and we got the victory.
We just tried today. We didn't never wanted to let up. We let some teams, the teams in the past that we play, get some explosion plays on us, so we figured they're going to come out and they're going to try to catch us with our... We just kept on telling ourselves that we had to keep it up every single time. Don't let them sneak one on us, and we didn't let them.
It was unbelievable, man. The crowd was I swear to God, the crowd is like 10 points on our favor. I mean, you saw how hard they were having with their calls and everything. It's great. I mean, they get so loud, and it's hard for them to hear, and that really helps us. It lets us tee off on them, you know?
We were playing great. Then that third quarter, we gave up a couple plays, and they were right back in it. But I never felt panicked. I don't think anyone else did. The defense, after they put up that 10th point, we shut them down again. I don't think they moved the ball at all.
Plan was right on point. We came in there, we attacked the holes we needed to attack, and we stopped the run really well.
It means a lot to me. That's pretty selfish, but certainly it does.
Well, you know, it felt pretty good. You know, we got the victory. You know, defense stepped it up. Offense came along. So, you know, it's a big win for us, beating number 18.
It doesn't matter about the stage. We could be playing in Coach Belotti's backyard with, you know, a movie camera out there. If we're playing the Huskies, it doesn't matter. We're going to be ready to go. When they come into our house, they're going to be in for a dogfight. We're always going to be ready to play the Huskies.
And that's the big question. With all the emotion last week against UCLA or yesterday, now you got to get ready for Washington, and you got to get it cranked up again.
Yeah, I don't think that'll be that much of a problem. I think that, again, the rivalry itself does a lot for everybody. The other thing is we've taken the first step in the Pac-10 race. We just have to keep going with that. We've got to build on that. The Huskies had a week off to prepare and rest up. We've got to be probably more fired up because of that.
You talked about the first step. Also, the first step in a very tough three-game stretch for your team, and you got one of them.
Well, we got one. We said we're going to play three top 10 teams in a row, and obviously we got the first one, and we get a chance now at home again for the second one. It's crucial that we take advantage of Autzen Stadium.
Welcome back, everyone. The Huskies are coming to Autzen Stadium, and that means Rick Neuheisel with his first appearance at Autzen Stadium, and I know the crowd's going to be ready. He's looking forward to it, too.
With Washington and the natural rivalry that exists between Washington and Oregon, for us to go in there, you know, crowd noise will be a huge factor. You know, we had success last year against them, so there'll be a revenge motive for Oregon against Washington. And, you know, we expect a raucous-type atmosphere, and we're going to have to play our very best to be successful. With respect to me, I can see where they want a chance to, and this is my chance to get after us, and, you know, this is our first chance to actually go to Eugene, so it'll be interesting.
All right, Coach, another sixth-ranked team coming to Eugene.
Huskies are a solid program. They've beaten Colorado at Colorado, Miami at their place. Marcus Tuiasosopo is an excellent athlete, maybe the most explosive offensive player in the nation.
Welcome back, everyone. Well, over the years, the Ducks have had some great linebackers, some playing in the pros, another who's already played in the pros. Here's Dennis Schrag.
Matt Smith can hit. Oh, Matt Smith had this play from the very beginning. He lays a hammer.
And Matt Smith can hit. But not swinging a bat regularly in more than 2 years can make even a past first-round draft pick a little rusty.
This could be dangerous.
It didn't take long for Smith to get into the swing of things.
It's fun now that I'm actually hitting the ball.
He's also having a lot of fun so far on the football field. 20 tackles in the first three games and one huge interception.
Steps, looks, throws it over the middle, intercepted! Matt Smith, he'll score! Matt Smith at the 20, Matt at the 10, he'll take it in! Oregon leads this football game!
Coming out of high school, Smith was selected by Kansas City as the 16th pick in the 94 Major League Baseball draft, and he even got a $1 million bonus. Smith played first base and pitched in the Royals organization for the next 4 years. He reached Double-A Wichita in the Texas League. Some of his fellow Wranglers like Mike Sweeney, Johnny Damon, and Carlos Beltran are up-and-coming Major League stars, but Smith never made it to the show.
I think it's probably natural. There's been times where I was like, wonder what would happen if I would have stuck with it or where I'd be at this point. But, I mean, it's a risky business, and a lot of guys don't make it.
Now the dream is to get drafted in another sport.
Heard some positive things, but I've also heard some things I need to work on, so just one of those things you'll wait and see, and can't expect too much. If it works, great. If not, I got my degree.
Matt Smith can hit baseballs just about as well as he can hit opposing football players, but it's hard for him to say which one is more fun.
A great tackle and a home run kind of both feel the same. Everything about it's perfect.
Smith says it wasn't an easy decision to give up the Major League dream, but once the decision was made to play football, choosing Oregon was an easy pick.
That was the team that I grew up watching. Always enjoyed Duck football. I got a lot of family that's went here, and so it was really a natural decision to come here.
There are times when Smith wonders what if, but for the most part, he has no regrets about his change of sport.
So I got to play minor league baseball for a few years. Now I'm playing major college football. So growing up, I always played all the sports, and I tried to do my best in all. And if I could make it to that level in both, I'd feel like that'd be quite an accomplishment.
All right, thanks, Dennis. And finally now, a chance for you, the fan, to be a star. It's Ask the Coach, and we get it on the fourth try.
I'd like to know if the intensity of our... These, you know, Coach Belotti, I'd like to know if.
No,
we're kids, okay. Coach Belotti, I'd like to know if the intensity of this crowd helped with the success of winning, because I know that we are intense, way intense.
Way intense. Yeah. What about that?
Well, the intensity, the enthusiasm, the noise, and the proximity of the crowd are what helps us. They do a great job.
Is this even a bigger week for you guys? I mean, Husky Week?
Husky Week is always huge, and obviously the implications for the Pac-10 race are big. We got them here. They're nationally ranked. It's awesome.
Well, of course, it's going to be a great, great game. The Oregon Ducks and the Washington Huskies will do it all here again next week on Oregon Football with Mike Belotti. Thanks for watching, everyone.